My grandmother was Jenny Wilson, and I was very lucky. I'm very lucky to say that. Interestingly, when I was about 9 years old, we were in the car on the way back from the country club in Virginia, and I was probably like, yeah, I think I was like 9, 8, something like that, and I realized that one day she was going to die. And I don't know why, I was in some conversation, and I just started to cry, like uncontrollably sobbing. Back in this car, she's rubbing my back, she says, I promise I'll do my level best to be your last living grandparent. And she did it. Also, if you like the sight of a grown man crying, I figured for a treat. They say that grief is the price that we pay for love, and unfortunately today that account is due. Thank you very much. Thank you for being here on behalf of myself and my family. We're just eternally grateful that you're with us celebrating the life of this incredible person. This is, I think, the 6th eulogy that I've ever given. And I hate to admit it, but they come pretty easy. So I just sit down, and it's kind of this cathartic thing, and I work through the grief, and then I get to talk about somebody. It feels really nice, right? It's a great way to honor someone. This did not come easily. I couldn't get it right. It's still not right. We're all feeling pretty lost without it, and this is just a symptom of that, to be frank. I'm a guy who has perhaps a way with words, I think, I've been told, and those words just didn't come. So there are a lot of things I could talk about today about my grandmother's life. She had a very interesting life, everybody knows that. She traveled a lot, she built some businesses, she had a big career. She was married twice to two men she really loved, but everybody knows that. We're going to talk about that in this room and in years to come and days to come. Today, what we're going to talk about is who she was and what she was about as a person, because I think that that's really important. She was a rare and fascinating human. I've never met anyone like her. She was impossible. You couldn't beat her. She was unstoppable, a force of nature. If she said she was going to do something, it just happened, as if by magic. She was diligent and industrious, patient, kind, competitive. You didn't want to play cards with her. You were going to lose money always, every time. And I did. She always tried to do the right thing. You know, she worked hard because she thought hard work was rewarding. She told the truth because lying seems stupid. She was generous. She liked to give, you know, to give. Not to get, but to give. She possessed this rare pragmatism that I think comes from laboring hard and losing over and over again. Right? It's a thing that you learn to do, to persevere when you lose. You learn a lot from it. She lost a lot. She won a lot, too, though. her start in life was not easy. I can't understate that. Her mother died when she was very young. And she was kind of the orphan of our family. She was passed around between loving grandparents and cousins, but she never had that nuclear family situation. I mean, she had siblings who she loved so much. But she never really had a parental structure in the traditional sense. And in some ways, it was the most incredible benefit to her. In other ways, it was this thing that she craved. And so, because she was task-oriented and very good at getting things done, she decided to endeavor to have a family. And she did. She did. It began with my mother, Debbie and Sandy. And then, you know, they got married to Mark, John, and then me, and Chase, and Gracie, and Ryan, and Barrett, and Dawn, and Hattie, and Sean, and Augie, and Autumn. And all of us. She was so proud to have a family. Sorry. But she dedicated her entire life to us. I mean it. She was my best friend. I talked to her every day. She was my chief advisor, my enforcer occasionally. I never had a single problem in my life that she didn't stage manage. It was outrageous. She would wake up in the middle of the night calling me at 3 o'clock in the morning. Did you pay your taxes? Yes, grandma. Okay, just a check. It concerned me too, because one day we went to bed. I don't always stay with you when we went to Florida. We went to bed, we left dishes in the sink, right? And I woke up at like 3 o'clock in the morning thinking, I'm just gonna knock those dishes out. And I walk into the kitchen in her house, and who's awake doing the dishes but Jeanette, right? My aunt and my mother are so fortunate, I think, to have many of her best qualities. You know, my mom has this incredible knack of people. She's extremely likable. She got that from my grandmother for sure. And intuition. That lady's got intuition. She got that from that lady. Much to my chagrin, I'm telling you.
Me too.
Yeah. And then my aunt. Really got her work ethic and her practicality, you know, and her sense of humor. You know, it's wonderful to see these incredible qualities that this great person had sort of filter out into our family. This is hard, guys.
You're doing good, man.
Get out of here, man. No, I mean, the problem is she's too good. I mean, I don't even like it at this point. I'm so hurt. Why'd she have to be so cracked? She'd love being a grandparent. My God, she's good at it, too. Really good at it. She was really good. She was like the Pied Piper. We'd follow her anywhere. Whether that was traveling across the globe or playing hooky from school or going to lunch or escaping to go to Target. There's a really funny story. As she got older, she was no longer allowed to drive her car or her golf cart. And Gracie, where are you, Gracie? Where are you?
She's outside.
Oh, of course she's outside. Missing this hour, I remember that. Gracie, my niece, was staying with my grandmother after school, and my grandmother, this is a year ago, 88 years old, she says, "Hey, Gracie, you want to get out of here?" And Gracie goes, "I don't think we're supposed to." She said, "Nah, we can do what we want." So she leaves her cell phone right at the house so no one can find her.
100 degrees.
And 100 degrees, and they walk a mile and a half to Target, and no one can find them. No one can find them. So, of course, Chase calls his employees, and they're dispatched. Mom and Deb are running all over the place, and they find her in Target in the toy aisle. No toys, if you can imagine. Gracie is an operator, I speak from experience. And Graham said, "Well, you know, I'll do what I want." Yeah, she did. She was so many things to so many people. You know, I look out in this crowd, and I know so many of these faces. It's like seeing a life made manifest in humans, right? For each one of you, there's a memory, you know, for me and for her and for you. It's just a nice thing to see. I know we knew her by many names. She was JJ, right? She was Nettie. Gam, right? There you are. Great Graham. She was the boss. She was always the boss. That was the trouble. Who's to say which title she loved the most, but Chase and I will just always know her as Gammy. I think I called her that when I was two and it stuck. She liked it. As I got older, Gammy became Graham, and then Gam, and occasionally Jeanette. I was upset. But it's still the one name that I know better than any other one, and the one that she knew better, and it's the one about her, the day that she died. That name means so much. Safety and comfort and unconditional love. She was in my corner, on our side, our entire lives. I was born with a best friend. It's the nicest thing in the world. I'll never forget it. I thought a lot about the fact that that love is gone, you know, forever. I'll never feel it again, probably. But I think it would be pretty selfish to withhold that, you know. So I think the best way to honor her memory is to love that way, unconditionally, with whole heart, with full generosity. Give me not to get, but just at all, love and support. That's how we can try. Though Jeanette's outlook on life is pretty simple, she knew life was not simple. It's really complicated. We're all in this spinning ball of dirt together, and we have no idea what we're doing. There are lots of questions and not a ton of answers. You know, unfortunately, we're born, we live a while, and we die. And over the course of that journey, she always tried. She did her best. She used to say to me, "You don't go around twice. If you want to do something, do it, just do it. You know, try, try, try." And so I would like to remember my grandmother in the following way. She was a decent, wonderful person. I love you with her whole heart and spent her entire life trying, trying, trying. Rest in peace.
Jeanette, what a lady. England had a little home, and we had ours. She loved unconditionally, and I will forever miss her. So I grew up in this town, and mother used to, this used to be a farm field, and she played with it in the Debbie, and now we're back here. My famous Paul Sewell. We were known in this town as the Jackson Brothers. And Debbie and I were blessed enough to have two amazing parents that were so giving and loving and kind. And that's where we embraced our hearts. And it's embraced our children's hearts. Those parents, the gifts that they have given us to make us be the humans that we are and the adults that we have become are incredible. Mother loved with her whole heart. She was an amazing force of nature. She was a true matriarch. She loved her family. Her family was everything. When Chet and Chase were born, those boys became her. They were her world. Everything she did was for them. It was unbelievable. When Gracie, Ryan, and Barrett and Autumn Rodney came into her life, she said, "You think you know love? You don't know love until you have a grandchild like that. A great grandchild." And she was blessed to have all of us. Thank you all for coming today with the amount of love and support that you all showed us. I can't tell you what it means. Thank you from the bottom of our heart. And I want to special thanks to my husband, who has mother loved him like a son. And he's been by my side for this entire journey. My sons, I love and adore you. Imagine that I let my grandchildren war. And I want to say thank you to my daughter-in-law. Not many people are blessed to have a daughter-in-law. An amazing human. She loved mother unconditionally. The things she did for our mother is forever etched in my heart. That the thing I want to recognize, meaning Susan, Babbitt, through this journey with mother, as they have known this journey before us, their love, their support, their wisdom, their encouragement. Thank you. Ann Ashford, thank you for your constant daily show of love via text. And it meant the world to me. And to my dear children, thank you all. You have been part of this life since we were very young. I love you so much. I love you. She appreciated you. Big Jack, our cellman, who is our family, broke his foot last night and he still managed to come today. Tony, Adam, Phil, thank you all for always being there for us. We love you.
Very proud of my son. It was a beautiful eulogy, and I couldn't really do any better than that. And all I want to say is that Jeanette Wilson, has meant so much to me personally. When I started dating Sandy, you know, I was a musician, you know, and she wasn't too fond of that idea. And it took me a while, but she ended up being my biggest cheerleader in life for all these years. And she's always been there for me and Sandy and our boys and all of our family. And all I can say is that thank you, Chad, for such a beautiful eulogy. And the only thing that I can give her, because I don't speak like he does, is my eulogy is going to be real musical for her, okay? So can we get Phil Clark and Arcadi up here? This is my eulogy to her.
And save our questions for another.